I think by now everyone in the coding realm and a lot of others in healthcare have heard about the historic changes that are going on with evaluation and management coding. They've been updated now for the first time in several years and are going to take effect January 1st of 2021 for those office and outpatient visits. But while a lot of people know about history and exam being eliminated, and yes, we're going to go on medical decision making, I really want to focus on a few of the key concepts that you're really going to want to know about those changes that are happening for January 21st of 2021. So let's take a look. Hey everyone, I'm Victoria. I'm a medical coder, auditor, educator, national speaker, blogger, and content creator for medical coding. And on my channel, I discuss tips, tricks, and tutorials to make you successful in your medical coding career. So one of the first things I want to talk about is the number of diagnoses. So if you remember our current E&M scoring methods, in order to get a high in the number of diagnoses, you would need to have 4 more points. And each diagnoses type was assigned a point. So an established problem that was stable would be 1 point, and an established problem that was uncontrolled would be 2 points. And even if you got 16, you know, all you needed was 4. So I used to tell people, as long as you've got 4 points, you're good. Don't worry about if you've got 16 or 17, because the max that you can have is 4. With the 2021 changes, that new versus established problem, not patient, but new versus established problem concept and that calculating of points has been pretty much eliminated. The only time you really see new problem referenced is that new problem with an uncertain prognosis, like the breast lump, where you have to do some additional stuff to figure out what exactly is going on with a patient, because they're coming in maybe and saying, you know, I've got this stabbing pain in my stomach, and you're like, yeah, I'm not quite sure what that is. Let's work you up, send you out for some ultrasounds and stuff and find out what's going on. I personally am just going to be a big fan of not having to calculate out all the points for all the diagnoses anymore. The second thing to point out is that the level selection criteria is exactly the same for new versus established patients. So a level 3 is a level 3 is a level 3. It doesn't matter if it's new or established. That criteria for selecting a level 3 is the same. Now, they're still going to have a different RVU and still have a different reimbursement for a new versus an established patient, but the selection criteria is the same. So why this is important is if you think about if you've ever gotten a new patient denial. This happens a lot, especially in these large group institutions. Sometimes they have 20 different family practices working under the same tax ID at 20 different locations. And they might see a new patient for that practice, but they're technically an established patient to that group that they've already seen another family practitioner, you know, at a different practice 5 miles down the road. So you wind up thinking it's a new patient. Provider bills it out as a new patient, but it's actually an established patient. They're established to that family practice group of 20 different practices working under that institution under the same tax ID number. And this gets handled a lot of different ways in billing organizations. Some people, when they get that new patient denial, will send it back to the provider and make them pick the new level of service, which is not okay. The other thing that they'll do is maybe they might just send it back to a coder and have them relook at it, which now we're having to waste time. It's sitting on someone's desk or sitting in someone's work queue and it's getting delayed. That's delaying our revenue. Or they might just cross it over to something else, which you cannot do. You cannot go, oh yeah, level 4 new patient means it's automatically a level 5 established patient. That's not how the E&M scoring works. But starting 2021, if you get a denial for a level 3 new patient visit and you look at it and go, oh yeah, this was an established patient, you can switch it right over to the same level established patient and get it right back out the door. So it's really going to speed up the process for working some of those new patient denials, and you won't have to worry that it's sitting on someone's desk or in someone's work queue and that it's going to sit there for so long that it might wind up getting hit for timely filing. The third concept you're going to want to understand with these new E&M guidelines is that if you are billing anything out separately with a separate CPT, it can no longer go into the calculation for your E&M level. So for example, if you're working cardiology and you have an EKG machine and you run that EKG, you read that EKG, which cardiologists do, you cannot also get points for doing that order for the EKG or review of the EKG within your E&M service, because you're already getting reimbursed for all that work within that CPT code. So you don't get to double dip and also calculate that to boost your E&M level up. The fourth thing to look out for is those time components. There's a lot of new things that are going to calculate into total time, and they're eliminating that more than 50% or the visit has to be dominated by counseling and coordination of care. So you really have to be familiar with those time and what is and is not considered, especially with ancillary staff stuff, because there's some stuff that providers, I think, might start thinking, oh yeah, I can count the time that the MA spends rooming the patient, and that's not part of the calculation. But actually, it says the time that the provider spends documenting in the EMR is considered part of their total time. And really, as always, be very cautious with that time, because you cannot see 26 one-hour long patient visits in one day. So get familiar with those time changes, because even those approximate times that we have currently for E&M are going to change to a time range, an exact time range for those 2021 changes, and the whole time concept is being revamped. Another thing I want to point out, and this is just one of the things that I've been telling my providers and it's easy for them to kind of conceptualize, is that if you look at your level 4 service, where you only need two things out of those columns to hit the level of service that you're picking, if you have a patient that has two chronic conditions that you are managing and you're doing prescription drug management, it is a level 4 service. Now, you have to be careful, though, about the MAC in your area and how they define what is prescription drug management. My area has currently, Novitas said, that simply refilling a medication is prescription drug management. Other areas say that, no, you have to either adjust the dosage, adjust the type of medication, it has to be a new medication or a discontinued medication. So be very careful about that prescription drug management concept, because that's still going to be determined by your Medicare contractor. The sixth thing I want to point out, I've had some discussions with about some of my coding comrades in the past, and that's about if you are obtaining history from a parent of a pediatric patient, where does that fall? Can that still count as getting history from someone other than the patient? So let's look at what exactly it says in these new E&M guidelines. So in our revised table, if you look for the amount or complexity of data to be reviewed or analyzed in our category 2, that category 2 concept has assessment requiring an independent historian. If you look at the E&M guidelines that were put out, it says that an independent historian is an individual, and it gives the examples of parent, guardian, surrogate, spouse, or witness who provides a history in addition to a history provided by the patient who is unable to provide a complete or reliable history, and it gives the examples of due to developmental stage. So a pediatric patient who maybe is a toddler and can't give a reliable history because of their developmental stage, and you get history from the parent, it counts as that independent historian review. The seventh and final thing I want to talk about is pay attention to your social determinants of health. And my friend Toni L. Holmes has talked about this in the past. She's working on her book. I expect every single one of you to buy it when it comes out and get several copies and give them away as Christmas presents. So social determinants of health actually counts as moderate risk if it impacts the patient's care, if it is strongly impacting the patient's care. So what are social determinants of health? They're things that can impact the patient's ability to take care of their own health or receive healthcare services. So a homeless patient that has diabetes, so that impacts their medical plan. A patient that's homeless can't store their insulin in a refrigerator. They might have to go to a church and store it there, or find somewhere that they can know is safe to have that so they can do their insulin injections. My local chapter at the AAPC has had some of our homeless organizations come in and speak to us in the past, and it is jaw-dropping and very eye-opening to hear someone who's been working with the homeless population in your area say things to you like, do you know that there is a camp of homeless patients living behind the Walmart that you shop in? You don't really realize the extent of the problem until you hear these stories. We actually had one of them come back and talk to us also about human trafficking, about the huge problems that we're having in our area from human trafficking because of being so close to places like New York and Philadelphia, and that they're kind of coming into our Allentown area where my chapter is, and, you know, going into the malls, and they say that it's like shooting fish in a barrel to pull in these girls from the mall because their parents aren't there. They're just shopping alone. So it's very shocking. If you have one of these organizations in your area, I would definitely recommend trying to get them to come and speak to your local chapter, because it is astonishing. So yeah, pay attention to those social determinants of health. If there's patients that are in foster care or in abusive relationships or have histories of those, that can impact your moderate decision-making for your level 4 services. So there is a lot more going on to these changes than just, oh, we're eliminating history and exam and it's going to be medical decision making. These whole concepts, look at those AMA guidelines, get familiar with them. And if you need some training, definitely check out my E&M training course. I'm giving half off until the end of June of 2020 through all of my YouTube family. So you can check that coupon code below and you will get half off through the end of June. And then it returns to its full price of $49 for the course, which is still actually really good for 2.5 CEUs. As always, don't forget to give this video a big thumbs up. Make sure you subscribe, hit that notification bell so you get the alert every time I post another one of these very helpful episodes. I will see you in the next episode, and until then, keep on coding on.